Public Affairs Broadcasting.
Special programming from Rockingham County Radio, rcrlive.com.
Good morning and welcome to Community Accents. I'm Dr. Cindy Wall Sarwi, Executive Director of the United Way of Rockingham County. Today you're going to hear from special guests from the Reidsville YMCA as well as American Red Cross. We have with us today Mrs. Heather Whitsett from the Reidsville YMCA and Mr. John Hughes from the American Red Cross. Thank you for joining.
Thanks for having us.
Debbie Moore, our campaign chair, is not able to be with us today, but I will provide the United Way campaign update. Right now, we're at $395,000. We hope to get several of our larger campaigns in the upcoming weeks. We have MillerCorps still out there, Gildan still out there, and AmCorps still out there waiting to report. So, and also met Michael Mills from the Western Rockingham side of the county. So we're really excited and can't wait to get those numbers in and hope to see that thermometer rise there and help us to get closer to that $800,000 goal that we have. Any one of you can be a hero and help support a life here in Rockingham County and make a difference. That is our campaign theme this year, is be a hero. And please know that regardless of the denomination, regardless of the amount of money you can choose to give to United Way, every dollar adds up to make a difference. We do need your support. So if you're a retiree out there and you do not have an employer to do a payroll deduction, you can pledge any amount of money. We can send quarterly reports out to you. You can pay by cash, check, any way that you want to make it work, we can work with you and customize your giving there. Also, if you are a small employer and you're not quite sure how to set up an employee campaign, please let us know. Call our office at 336-342-7768, and we can always talk you through and walk you through how to set up an employee campaign. It can be as easy as bringing an agency speaker in. We can come in and say a few words about how United Way dollars support the community, or we could just drop off the information and let you run the campaign yourself. But we do need support from our community, from all walks of the community, from Reidsville, Eden, and Western Rockingham. The majority of our programs and services, which United Way supports 31 different programs and services across Rockingham County, are countywide services. There are only a handful of services that are specific to one area of the county, but most of our services are countywide. So please know we need all parts of the county supporting the United Way campaign this year. I'm going to turn it over first to the Reidsville YMCA. And Heather, thanks for being with us here today.
Absolutely.
Can you start off by just telling us a little bit about yourself and your role here at the Reidsville YMCA?
Sure. My relationship with the YMCA started about 17 years ago when my son attended his first soccer game with the Reidsville Y.
Yes.
At that point, my husband and I became coaches, and I became what they call a Y-lifer.
Mm-hmm.
So hopefully I'll be around for a good while. From there, I worked in sports, worked in membership, was here at the Reidsville Y for several years, then moved to the Greensboro Y, then back to Reidsville about 4 years ago in the executive director position. I am a Rockingham County native, and I do live in Wentworth, so it's very, very nice to be home.
I'm sure. And so being that you've served different YMCAs, mm-hmm. you bring a lot of experience with you to this position, so we're excited to have you here bringing that.
Thank you.
What role does United Way play in your programs and services?
The United Way is really crucial with our programs and services. They primarily fund our after-school enrichment program and mm-hmm. our summer camp enrichment. So that's making sure that children have a safe and positive, nurturing environment to stay in when their parents are at work and unable to care for them on their own.
What type of numbers do you have? Like how many participants do you have in those programs?
Just to talk overall about the YMCA memberships, we
yes.
have about 4,400 members.
Wow.
Yeah.
I didn't realize that.
I know. And over 975 of those are youth. So big variety here in the community, and our memberships are from single-parent families to two senior households. We really do a good job and very intentionally make membership open and welcoming to all. So we, as you stated before, cover, you know, the county. We're
mm-hmm.
not just a Reidsville-specific organization.
Yes.
We do work across the county as well.
So you can have someone living in Western Rockingham mm-hmm. or Eden and still be a member of your local YMCA in
exactly.
Reidsville.
Exactly.
Okay. All right. What is your membership criteria for the YMCA?
There's not a specific criteria. Again,
okay.
open for all, so we do have memberships that are pretty suitable to all households. And outside of membership, we have what we call service units. So mm-hmm. you don't have to be a membership to participate in things such as after school or summer enrichment programming.
Okay.
So overall, in the course of a year, we serve about 8,000 people. And that counts them once as a member or once if they're going to play youth sports or summer camp, adult water aerobics. We have just about everything here, a wide variety of offerings from boot camp to senior water exercise. So
I was seeing that listed when I walked in that you have the boot camp that you started. I guess you kicked off the new year maybe with it. That is that early morning?
We have two. We have an early morning and we have a 6 p.m. as well.
Okay.
And they really get those folks moving.
I'm sure. Yeah. I'm sure. I saw some of them walking out here that looked like they had a good workout.
Yes.
Can you give us a scenario, moving back to the programs that United Way supports with the enrichment activities, can you give us a scenario of what an after-school enrichment activity and another scenario of what a summer program enrichment activity would look like?
Sure, absolutely. We have a new senior program director here, Elliot Hall, who came on board within the last year, and he's done a ton of positive changes for the program to add additional enrichment opportunities, which is, of course, is what we're looking for.
Exactly, yes.
If during the school year, what the kids are going to do is get settled, get picked up from their individual classes, and kind of form a home base there in the cafeteria of the school. And we do serve South End, Moss Street, and Williamsburg. We're lucky enough to have our programs on site there, which is very convenient for parents because they're dropping off and picking up their kids at the same location.
Absolutely.
So they get to that home base there in the cafeteria, and then they'll work on homework first and foremost, because that is what we found time in and time out that parents really do appreciate, is that when they get home, they have that time to themselves, and they're not worried about doing homework. So we get that out of the way first, and then we typically move to a snack time. And then we have some team or group play. We work on character traits, so caring, responsibility, honesty, and respect. So we have some themed lessons, about those different items. And then the enrichment opportunities that we've added. We have someone coming out once a week to do tennis. We also have storytellers that come in and talk to us, environmental education. We have one of our firecracker instructors, Sabrina Andrews, who goes out twice a month and does kids Zumba on site.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Oh, that's cool.
And that is fun for the kids, and it's also very fun to watch.
I can imagine.
Yeah. And so they go through that, and then it's pickup time. So then the parents come and grab the children, and some of the kids are with us from when they get out of school at 2:30 until 6 o'clock when the program closes. So that gives parents time enough to, you know, finish up their work day, maybe run a couple errands, and then come and pick up their children. So it's really good for parents to have that to be able to rely on.
Exactly, and that streamlines the process because the students do not have to be bused anywhere else afterwards, and they can just move straight from their last period of the day or last class of the day on into the enrichment activities. And it also provides that extra quality time for the parents and the children.
Right,
Once they get home. Well, that's good. How about the summer enrichment program?
We do some similarities there. Again, the same character traits. Our kids, who we call Y kids, know them in and out, and so they know what to expect. But again, we're going to work on those throughout the summer. We have a different theme for each week, so we're going to continue to add those enrichment activities with the tennis and the outdoor education. We were fortunate enough to receive a grant. We're actually going to have an outdoor classroom this summer.
Oh.
We're going to grow some vegetables because we have some children that have never seen anything grow from seed to actual fruit or, you know, vegetables. So we're going to work on that this summer. That's going to be new for us. We do at least one large field trip a week. So we're going to take them either to the Natural Science Center or to the zoo. We've done Fairystone Park. So we get them out of the building a little bit. We also go into the community. We do have 1 week that's just Hometown Heroes.
Okay, yes, that's awesome. Yes.
Yes, and so we take them to local businesses and really let them see what could be their next step ahead, so what they could be doing. And that could be anything from going to the firehouse to going to local car dealerships to see how to work on cars and learn basic parts. So
that's great exposure.
It is, and we try to keep them interested because 10-week summers is a long summer.
Right, yes.
And we have
yes.
some children that will come for the full 10 weeks for childcare, and then we have some parents also that just use it as a fun opportunity for their children to have something to do for 1 or 2 weeks. They'll look at the full week's summer worth of schedule and say, oh, well, I know my child is very geared towards science, so we'll definitely hit that week that they're going to the Science Center.
Right, right. And they can do it topic specific or however they want to do it.
Exactly.
That's great. Can you speak to how United Way dollars support these programs?
Absolutely. The United Way dollars help us tremendously. being able to again add additional enrichment opportunities to those programs and make sure that they're, you know, fulfilling and interesting for the children. They also allow us to spend some of our funding in other areas that we would be unable to do. So, you know, we will serve in the course of a school year in summer 75 to 90 children with United Way dollars with that enrichment programming. But again, you have to think of that 4,400 members who are also being positively impacted by that that support from the United Way dollars. And it's crucial for operations.
That's great. What is the typical cost of the enrichment program?
Okay, for our after-school program, it's $150 for members and $175 for non-members. And to put that into perspective, a youth can get a membership for $12.
Okay.
So it's $12 a month. So it makes good, you know, economical sense to go ahead and get that membership. And then for the summer camp, it's $100 for members and $120 for non-members, and that is per week. The after-school is a monthly cost. The summer camp's a weekly cost.
Okay.
Yep.
Okay.
And we do, and again, we're able, because of the United Way dollars, for some of those parents, although those prices are affordable for what we have in our community and we're able to make them affordable, we're able to go above that and even offer some scholarship dollars for parents who are really struggling.
Okay. All right. And that's wonderful that you really harp on those character traits, because that provides continuity throughout the year with the students that are in the year-round enrichment programs as well as the summer enrichment programs.
Yeah, and what we've seen that the kids also really enjoy is in the summer programs, we have our after-school sites that all come together. So they're seeing kids and they're meeting new people that they don't typically see, you know, during the school year. So it really introduces them to a wide variety of people.
Exactly.
Yep.
That is great. Well, you do a great job here.
Oh, thank
you for what you do. We greatly appreciate it. How do you see United Way dollars impacting the community as a whole?
Again, I think for parents to know that their children are going to be in a safe environment, a nurturing environment, they're going to get some of that family time back at the end of the evening with things that have already been done by the United Way support. You know, their children have already been supported and already been moved along for that day.
Right.
So I think just to give parents back time, and we all know that if there's one thing that every family, busy family, is short on is time. So you're actually adding time back into a family's day, which I think is just crucial.
You're exactly right. I used to teach at Rockingham County College, and I was teaching a lot of fitness classes, and I used to really instill in my students, you can always find time. You can always find time. And now I'm on the other end where that time is not always easy to find, and to work in exercise or any quality time that you need for me, you know, for yourself there.
Right. And what we've seen this year as well with our lovely weather we've had the past couple weeks.
Yes.
outside of that after school and summer camp, we also provide all daycare. So when we've had so many out of school days, we've been able to offer daycare during the day so parents can get to work.
Wow,
so again, we're enabling everyone to kind of continue on with their typical routine,
right?
And we'll take care of the kids for you.
Well, that's nice.
Yeah,
that's great. I'm sure parents really appreciate
that. They utilize it.
Are there any programs or services that you would like to speak about with the Reidsville YMCA that I have not touched on?
Well, we do have some exciting events coming up.
Okay,
We have a GLOW Zumbathon, which all of our Zumba fanatics are looking forward to. It's going to be on March the 13th. From 5:30 to 7. We actually do use that as a fundraiser for our scholarship campaign. But it's fun. It's free. You do need to pre-register here at the Y. I think we have a couple spots remaining, but not much. And that's just going to be an hour and a half of fun and dancing and fellowship.
Okay.
Outside of that, we have our Healthy Kids Day, which that's an annual event, and that's coming up on April 25th.
Okay.
And that's here at the Y from 1 to 3 o'clock. We have our staff and our folks here, but we also reach out into the community. The Annie Penn Foundation is helping us to sponsor this year, and we'll have everything from obstacle course to dentists.
Oh, wow.
So a lot of fun things for the kids to do, but a lot of information for parents as well.
Yes. Make sure for both of those events that you send us pictures, and we can put them on our Facebook and our website as well.
Absolutely.
We can make sure that we help market your organization too.
Okay.
Also. Anything else?
I think that's
okay.
it.
Okay, yeah. All right. Let's move it over to the American Red Cross. Mr. John Hughes, thank you for being with us today.
Thank you for having me.
I greatly appreciate it. Can you tell us a little bit about your role with the American Red Cross?
Well, my role with the American Red Cross is I'm the executive director for the Red Cross serving the Piedmont Triad. So that's an 11-county area, and we have offices in six of those areas, one of those being Rockingham County.
Okay. All right. And what role does United Way play in the American Red Cross programs and services?
Well, in Rockingham County, as in most communities, United Way plays a huge role, a very significant, important role, specifically in Rockingham County. The United Way plays the role of funding two key programs serving the community. One of those being disaster program, and the other being the food pantry.
Yes.
And both of those are really critical basic need services to the community, helping people in times of need for food, certainly basic need, as well as times of need following a disaster where they may have lost everything, and they certainly need help at least immediately following that time.
To get started. And I have been with you when you've spoken to businesses and done your presentation about how disaster services work, and when you brought in the teddy bear and the basic necessities. And, you know, when you put it in perspective like that, I can imagine how many people you can console with just the basics of a toothbrush and a stuffed animal to maybe make them feel better when they're, you know, faced with some traumatic experience like that.
Well, you're absolutely right, because a big part of recovery following any traumatic event, but particularly a disaster, if you've lost your home or at least temporarily, it's just the emotional impact of that is huge, you know, on individuals. And we just don't, unless we've been through it personally, we don't understand what that impact may be. So there's emotional support that has to be provided there. And so we have some of our volunteers who are licensed counselors who work with the folks. And part of what we do is we're just there to help the people by supporting them to have a shoulder to lean on, an arm to hold on to. That's a big part of it. But you talked about the bear, the stuffed animal.
Uh-huh.
That's something that we provide for children who maybe that may be all they have left.
That's right.
They're starting
that's
over true. Again, and we're giving them that, something to hold on to. Of course, there are adults who want to have that as well, frankly.
Mm-hmm.
But we give them, everybody, a comfort kit, which is a bag full of personal care items. And that's the toothbrush you talked about. It may be soap, toothpaste, washcloth, a razor. Not in the children's bag. We don't put razors.
Exactly.
But you know, personal needs like that, as you said, we don't think about until we don't have it.
Right.
And they're going to be going to stay in a hotel, perhaps, where we're putting them up, or maybe they're going to stay with family or friends. And just, can they even brush their teeth? You know, those basic necessities.
Exactly.
And then that's part of getting them started back on the road to recovery as we help them through that process. We want to empower them for their own recovery, but we're there to help them through that process, keep giving them what they need to get started, and that is shelter, clothing, food. They may have some emergency medical needs, such as, when I say emergency, not hospital, going to the hospital type of needs.
Right.
But they may have prescription medications, eyeglasses, things they need just for basic survival.
Right.
So that we can help them with those kinds
of things. Because oftentimes they're walking out of a burning house or whatever it may be, whatever disaster it may be, with just the clothes they have on their back.
And sometimes not even that.
Not even that. That's right. That's right. Can you talk us through and you've given us a lot of information there, but can you talk us through a specific scenario of what a disaster service team would be, how it would take place, like from the time you get the call, kind of walk us through what
sure.
the steps would be?
Sure, absolutely. Well, the first thing a lot of people ask is, how does Red Cross get notified?
Mm-hmm.
And we can be notified from a lot of different sources. It could be the next door neighbors could call and tell us there's a fire next door. But most often, the call comes to us through the county emergency communication system, and that's often activated by the fire department themselves, the firefighters on the scene, because we're not first responders fire and EMS and so forth. We don't want to get in the way of their work. We don't have flashing lights that we go out and so forth. But when the firefighters arrive on the scene and they sort of determine the situation once they get there and they see what the magnitude of the fire is, they see that people are going to be displaced, they then can put the call out to say, we need the Red Cross.
Okay.
And that's when the call comes to us. A call goes through our 24-hour system, because we're available 24/7 for that service. And so then a call or a page would go to our disaster captain, who's on call or on duty at that time, our team captain, and they then activate the other members of their team. We normally respond we like to respond with three people at least. Sometimes we may go with two, but we just don't go alone because we don't know what we're going to get into.
Mm-hmm.
So we always
mm-hmm.
like to have a couple of people because of managing what may need to be managed when we arrive on the scene, and also for safety reasons.
Exactly.
But sometimes the team meets at our office and goes out together in a vehicle. Other times they meet, one person who's closest may get the vehicle and go, and others may take their personal vehicles. But they meet up wherever, at some location. It may be at the scene of the actual fire or disaster. And their first concern is, where are the people? Who are the people that were affected?
Mm-hmm.
Let's get those people. Let's get them away from what's going on. Let's
right.
get them away from... you know, people asking them questions, from having to stand there perhaps and watching their house burn,
mm-hmm.
or just whatever may be going on at that moment that's stress-inducing for them and a very difficult situation, so that we can begin the process, that healing process with them and that getting their lives back together process, thinking about, here's what's happened, what do you need, what are the resources available, and so forth as we start that process. First and foremost, making sure that we want to comfort them and say, don't worry about this right now, or don't worry about that right now. Let's just make sure that you've got a place to stay right now. Let's
right.
make sure you've got food. Let's make sure you've got clothing. Let's make sure your basic medical needs are met and so forth. Let's do those things first. And then let's start to talk about what's next and help them through that process.
That is wonderful. And I think I wanted you to talk through that because I think a lot of people don't realize what role American Red Cross plays in disaster services. So
yeah.
I wanted to, you know, you hear the blood mobiles and everyone knows about the food pantry, which we'll speak on as well. But I think a lot of times people do not realize how specifically involved you are with that as well. And how United Way dollars help support that. Can
well,
you speak to that
well,
as well?
Well, let me just say too, along with that, one other piece of that, is that when I talked about the fire department arrives on the scene and they
yes.
they see what's going on and then they may make the call that said, we need Red Cross.
Mm-hmm.
Well, it's not always, that call is not always going out because there were people living in a house, victims of that disaster, who need our assistance.
Mm-hmm.
It may be that the firefighters and the first responders are responding to some other type of disaster. It could even be an industrial fire or
yes.
hazardous chemical situation or some other type of situation that they are directly involved in that could be in extreme conditions, a lot of or in extreme cold like we've had recently,
uh-huh.
or it could be extreme heat, or it could be over a long period of time, and they need support. And part of what we're doing is going out to support them with our canteen service to go and provide refreshments for them, food, cold drink, hot drink, soup, whatever may be needed for that time to help them through that process of providing comfort and aid to them and supporting what they're doing. But to your question, Cindy, is the support from United Way for disaster, our disaster services, specifically helps to fund that relief, the response. Now, disaster, I will say, There's a lot more to it than just the responding to a disaster,
uh-huh.
what we do.
Yes.
It's really a cycle, and the cycle is three things. It's preparedness. Preparedness is how we prepare individuals, businesses, communities, how to deal with disaster or
mm-hmm.
emergencies. We want to help people be better prepared to, in fact, avoid and provide for mitigation around disasters, and we're doing a lot more around that kind of thing and preparedness. Such as our home fires campaign, where over a five-year period, we've just launched it in October, where we're going to be going into neighborhoods and actually into homes and making sure that people have smoke alarms and installing
okay.
smoke alarms where they don't and putting in fresh batteries where they do and things like and doing education. So that's part of preparedness,
mm-hmm.
And also making sure that we have the necessary agreements in place for sheltering when a shelter needs to open.
Mm-hmm.
Again, this recent weather we've had some real scares in recent weeks. In fact, we did have some shelters open because of the cold weather.
Mm-hmm.
But so that kind of thing that doesn't just happen
right.
overnight or automatically. It's something that we have to prepare ahead of time. We have to have the resources in place, the materials, the people. Make sure everything is positioned where it needs to be. And in fact, within recent weeks with the cold weather, we had people working during the daytime, moving trailers of supplies, cots and blankets and those kinds of things around to where we thought there might be shelters open if we got the call to do that.
Mm-hmm.
But So there's that preparedness piece, there's the response piece I talked about, and then there's the recovery piece, which is that ongoing part of making sure people get their life, or that a community gets back together, mm-hmm. back to some sense of stability pre-disaster. And that's not something we can do alone. That's how we have to collaborate with many other organizations and resources in the community, governmental and nonprofit and faith-based, to help in those recovery efforts. But United Way funding specifically goes to support in that disaster relief and the recovery for people, or in the response and recovery. And so that's all that goes into us being prepared for that team to roll when the call comes in. And that's all the training that has to happen. That's all the supplies and materials that have to be ready to go. So we're ready to go and help people at the time, and that we can provide them with the financial assistance on the scene, so that they have then what they need to go and start purchasing what they need to be purchasing personally for their food, their clothing, and so forth.
Well, thank you. And you have a great group of volunteers. I've had the pleasure in the last 2 years working with your volunteers from American Red Cross, and I would tell you, and both yours too, Reidsville YMCA as well, both of y'all have sent a large number of volunteers to the Mud and Music Mayhem and other events that we've had, and I've had the pleasure of working with, we just have great community volunteers. So thank you for what you do in supporting the United Way also. How many families or individuals did you support through United Way dollars for disaster services?
Last year, it was we actually responded to, I believe it's 29 actual disasters that occurred in the course of the year, and that was 82 individuals in those homes that we assisted. And of course, it varies.
Right. You know, in knowing what that would be.
It could be a house with one person. It could be a house with 20 people.
Yes.
I mean, you know,
yes.
You really don't
know. That's true. That's true. It's hard to pinpoint that average. That number, I'm sure, can change from year
Absolutely,
to year.
Absolutely, it does.
I want to make sure that we have time to hit on the food pantry.
Absolutely.
Can you talk a little bit about the food pantry? Because I know that's one of the key staples here in Rockingham County and one of the key areas that United Way supports as well.
It is. It's a huge and incredibly important area, and it's an area that we've been seeing in recent years certainly an increase in demand for.
Yes.
Which I'm sure comes as no surprise to anyone.
Mm-hmm.
But we at the food pantry, we're open Monday through Thursday every week. And we also, at times, you know, if we have enough food on the shelves, we might be open more than that. But
right.
I say food on the shelves because that really is the issue. The demand is so high. We don't want to be open for people to come in if we don't have the food to give them. So sometimes we have to close the doors at times where we don't have enough food on the shelves. But United Way supports that, or the support from United Way is really critical, because what it allows us to do is to buy additional food through Second Harvest Food Bank. That's where the bulk of the food for the pantry comes from. There are certainly other sources with local grocery stores, for example, and certainly the food drives that the community does throughout the year that are just so important. But the consistent that we count on week after week, month after month, is from the Second Harvest Food Bank. And so that's where not only United Way, but other funders in the community, individuals as well as companies and other foundations that support our efforts to purchase that food so we can have it. Because we are providing, last year, just to give you an example, we provided food to almost 18,000 individuals in the county. And that was over 29,000 bags of food that were distributed. And so that's a lot of food. On an average month, we have anywhere from about 550 to 650 people coming in to get food.
That's a lot.
It is.
Well, thank you for what you do through American Red Cross, for your disaster services, as well as everything you do, all the programs and services. Because I know we support two of your programs, but you do so much more than that. And we greatly appreciate everything that you do. And I know we're out of time here. And I just wanted to say to the community, thank you for your support to United Way of Rockingham County. Please contact us at 336-342-7768 for any additional information that you may need to make an informed decision of supporting your local United Way. Thank you.